The Malthusian perspective on population growth. This topic is from Unit 1 of Socio Paper 504 entitled Social Demography, which is one of the elective papers for the PG students of Sociology, second semester, Dhanamanjuri University. Before I begin my lecture on the given topic, let me just give you a brief introduction first on social demography and then secondly on pre-modern population doctrines. As we all know, formal demography limits its object of study to the measurement and statistical analysis of population processes, while the broader field of social demography analyzes the relationship between economic, social, cultural, and biological processes influencing population. In short, it is a field of study which is concerned with the analysis of how social and cultural factors are related to population characteristics. It is a study of the determinants and consequences of population change and is concerned with everything that influences or can be influenced by population size, population growth or decline, population processes, that is how the trends in fertility, mortality and migration are determining population size, and how these three main variables are associated with factors such as aged marriage, marital status, levels and types of morbidity, rural urban migration and so forth. Population distribution, that is where people are located and why they are located at a particular place. And population structure is age and sex structure, that is how many males and females of each age group are there, and population characteristics, that is to say what are people like in terms of variables such as income, education, occupation, family and household relationships, immigrant status and many other characteristics that add up to who we are as individuals or groups of people. Now, coming to pre-modern population doctrines, we find that in the 5th century BC, the school of Confucius in China discussed the relationship between population and resources. And it was suggested that the government should maintain a balance between population and resources and should move people from overpopulated to underpopulated areas. Nonetheless, population growth was encouraged in the doctrine of Confucius, the great Chinese philosopher. In 360 BC, Plato emphasized the importance of population stability rather than growth. To him, population quality is more important than quantity, and that an ideal city-state should have only 5,040 citizens. In 340 BC, Aristotle, student of Plato, advocated that the number of children be limited by law and population size should be limited through abortion. In the Roman Empire, the reigns of Julius and Augustus Caesar were marked by clearly pronatalist doctrines. Then coming to the Middle Ages in Europe, which followed the decline of Rome, it was characterized by a combination of both pronatalist and antinatalist Christian doctrines. In 14th century, Ibn Khaldun, one of the great Arab historians and philosophers, argued that population growth is inherently good because it increases occupational specialization and raises incomes. In 1500 and 1800, mercantilism maintained that a nation's wealth was determined by the amount of precious metals it had in its possession. And increasing national wealth depends on a growing population that can stimulate export trade. Thus, population growth was seen as essential to an increase in national revenue. Mercantilist doctrines were supported by the emerging demographic analysis of people like John Brown, William Petty, and Edmund Halley. In the 18th century, Sussmans built on the work of Brown and others and added his own analysis to it. To him, a larger population was always better than a smaller one and was in direct contradistinction to Plato, and he valued quantity over quality. It is important to note that two important essays on population size, one by Scottish philosopher David Hume and another by Robert Wallace, influenced Malthus. One of the famous reactions against mercantilism was by Quesnay, the founder of the physiocratic school of thought. According to him, the number of people depends on the means of subsistence, and that land, not people, is the real source of wealth of a nation. Therefore, population size depends on the wealth of the land, which is stimulated by free trade, laissez-faire. This concept of laissez-faire, that is, let people do as they choose, was picked up by Adam Smith. From these ideas sprang the belief that there is a natural harmony between economic growth and population growth, with the latter depending always on the former. Thus, Smith felt that population size is determined by the demand for labor, which is in turn determined by the productivity of the land. These ideas are important to us because Smith's work served as an inspiration for the Malthusian theory of population. Condorcet, who pursued a life devoted to mathematics and philosophy, wrote a sketch for an historical picture of the progress of the human mind. He was a visionary who saw the outlines of liberal democracy more than a century in advance of his time. According to him, technological progress has no limits. Condorcet thus saw prosperity and population growth increasing hand in hand, and if the growth ever crosses its limit, the final solution would be birth control. Similar ideas were being expressed by William Godwin. He says that scientific progress would enable the food supply to grow far beyond the levels of his day, and that such prosperity would not lead to overpopulation. He believed that most of the problems of the poor were due not to overpopulation, but to the inequities of social institutions, especially greed and accumulation of property. Population doctrines and theories prior to Malthus were of two opinions, either pronatalist or antinatalist, and were often utopian. Thomas Robert Malthus had just graduated from Cambridge, and he read and contemplated the works of Godwin, Condorcet, and others who shared the utopian view of the perfectibility of human society. His first edition, quote, "Essay on the Principle of Population as it Affects the Future Improvement of Society," with remarks on the speculations of Mr. Godwin, M. Condorcet, and other writers, was published anonymously in 1798. The theme of the essay was to refute the utopian effusions of Condorcet and Godwin. In his first edition, Malthus began with two postulates. First, that food is necessary to the existence of man. Secondly, that the passion between the sexes is necessary and will remain nearly in its present state. Further, he goes on to argue that, quote, "The power of population is indefinitely greater than the power in the earth to produce subsistence for man. Population, when unchecked, increases in a geometrical ratio. Subsistence increases only in arithmetical ratio. The effects of these two unequal powers must be kept equal. This implies a strong and constantly operating check on population from the difficulty of subsistence," unquote. In 1803, he published the second edition of his essay, and emphasis was more on arguments against the English poor laws, that is, welfare benefits for the poor, and proposed moral restraints as a preventive check on rapid population growth. Malthus then spent 5 more years and brought out another revised edition, and subsequently 4 more editions were published, and a 6th in 1826 and the 7th edition in 1872 posthumously. He argued that the tendency of the population to grow faster in relation to its means of subsistence had led to human misery. This work of Malthus is a landmark in the history of population studies, and it brought both honor and criticism to him. Now, coming to causes of population growth, according to Malthus, population growth is generated by a powerful instinct, that is the urge to reproduce. If there were no checks on population growth, human beings would multiply to an incalculable number. The ultimate check to growth is lack of food, that is the means of subsistence. And these means of subsistence are limited by the amount of land available, technology, and social organization. Taking the whole earth, the human species would increase as the numbers 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128, 256, and the subsistence as numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. In 2 centuries, therefore, the population would be to the means of subsistence as 256 to 9. His main argument is that populations tend to grow more rapidly than the food supply, and it will outstrip the food supply, and lack of food will ultimately put a stop to the increase of people. Malthus recognized two powerful checks. The positive checks to population growth are those measures which tend to weaken and destroy the human frame and shorten human life, such as unwholesome occupations, severe labor and exposure to the seasons, bad and insufficient food and clothing due to poverty, common diseases and epidemics, wars, famine, etc. Preventive checks would include all possible means of birth control. However, to Malthus, the only acceptable means of birth control was moral restraint, that is, to postpone marriage either for a time or permanently. Any other means of birth control or any improper means was viewed as a vice that would lower the dignity of human nature. To Malthus, the consequence of population growth was poverty, and that people have a natural urge to reproduce, and increase in the food supply cannot keep up with population growth. To him, instead of population growth depending on the demand for labor, as Smith argued, the urge to reproduce always forces population pressure to precede the demand for labor. Thus, overpopulation would force wages down. At such low wages, with a surplus of labor and the need for each person to work harder just to earn a subsistence wage, cultivators would employ more labor, put more acres into production, and thus increase the means of subsistence. Thus, Malthus believed that this cycle of increased food resources leading to population growth, then leading to too many people for available resources, then leading back to poverty, was a part of a natural law of population. Each increase in the food supply only meant that eventually more people could live in poverty. In this way, he essentially blamed poverty on the poor themselves. Now, avoiding the consequences, Malthus suggested that the well-educated, rational person would perceive in advance the pain of having hungry children or being in debt, and would postpone marriage until he was sure that he could avoid that pain. If that motivation existed and the preventive check was operating, then the miserable consequences of population growth could be avoided. So, the only way to break the cycle is to change human nature. Malthus felt that if everyone shared middle-class values, the problem would solve itself. He saw that as impossible, though, since not everyone has a talent to be a virtuous, industrious, middle-class success story. But if most people at least tried, poverty would be reduced considerably. So, the major consequence of population growth, according to Malthus, is poverty. Within that poverty, though, is the stimulus for action that can lift people out of misery. So, if people remain poor, it is their own fault for not trying to do something about it. For that reason, Malthus was opposed to the English poor laws, that is, welfare benefits for the poor, because he felt they would actually serve to perpetuate misery. Now, Malthus has been criticized on the following points. First, the assertion that food production could not keep up with population growth. Secondly, the conclusion that poverty was an inevitable result of population growth, and third, the belief that moral restraint was the only acceptable preventive check. Malthus was aware of the Industrial Revolution, but he was skeptical for its long-run value and agreed with physiocrats that real wealth was in agricultural land. He was convinced that the increase in manufacturing wages that accompanied industrialization would promote population growth without increasing the agricultural production necessary to feed those additional mouths. Malthus paid little attention to the economic statistics that were available to him. He either failed to see or refused to acknowledge that technological progress was possible and that its end result was a higher standard of living. The crucial part of Malthus' ratio of population growth to food increase was that food would not grow exponentially. Malthus' argument that poverty is an inevitable result of population growth is also open to scrutiny. There are problems with Malthus' belief that the poor laws contributed to the misery of the poor by discouraging them from exercising prudence. Historical evidence has revealed that between 1801 and 1835, those English parishes that administered poor law allowances did not have higher population growth rates than those in which poor law assistance was not available. Criticisms of Malthus do not, however, diminish the importance of his work. There are good reasons for using Malthus as a point of departure in the discussion of population theory. These are the reasons that made his work influences in his day and make it influential even now. There's little to do with whether his views are right or wrong. According to Davies, Malthus's theory are not now and never were empirically valid, but they nevertheless were theoretically significant. Part of Malthus's significance lies in the storm of controversy his theory stimulated. Skuba has argued that one of Giller's motivations in trying to develop a new discipline of demography was to pressure French academics to see that statistical analysis of births and deaths would show that Malthus was wrong about his claim that population growth inevitably led to poverty. Once again, the power of Malthusian thought lies partly in the strength of opposition that he aroused. Despite its several inherent weaknesses, it has revived time and again, and the name of Malthus can never be scored off from the history of population thought. Thank you. Thank you.